Just to give you a flavor for what it feels like, you know, the day one, you know, I sit in my seat, they're about, you know, it's a, just a real diverse group of people in the classroom. And, you know, when you when you start the class, they call it opening the case, right? So my first class, never forget it, Melvin Menendez was a professor, and the case was a Procter & Gamble case about consumer products. So you have to open the case, which means somebody's got to start off the conversation about this case. So you read about a 15, 20 page thing about the company, some issue they're facing, and then you have to open the case. Opening the case is where there's the most pressure, because you have to basically lay out all the issues. So he calls on a guy, Paul Stoneham, and I mean, the way he ripped through this case was like, I was almost like ready to just call and drop out. I was like, there's no way I could compete with this right here. But, you know, he just ripped through 15 minutes, flawless analysis. You know, he did everything from the marketing creative side to the numerical side, and he just tore it apart. And literally, like, we all, you know, a couple of us were like, okay, you know, right after this, we'll go to the registrars, we'll get our money back, we'll be all good. But it just really showed the level, and it turned out that his background was in consumer products, and that's why
Gotcha. He
nailed it so well. But that's what it was. It was a collection of people that all had already had experience, and in some cases, significant experience in certain areas. And you basically were in a classroom with a set of experts. They were all expert in something. So you're just learning, just unbelievable learning on a daily basis from the professors and also from your classmates. But what was most important about that experience for me was just the relationships. So to this day, 80 people in my section, I could call any one of them with anything, ask
really?
Them to do anything. It's just a very close-knit group. When I left business school, we actually ran the magazine full-time and we raised some money. One of our investors was a section mate who gave us some of the capital we needed to start the magazine. So the relationships there were worth the tuition, basically.
Whatever became of the magazine?
So the magazine, when I graduated from business school, we went and launched the magazine. I say that when you're doing something entrepreneurial, I'm sure you've had this experience, you somehow lose your hearing, right? So we were in like meeting after meeting and everybody was like, don't do it. This is a horrible idea. Like we would go into meetings that were like horrible and we'd come out like, that was a pretty good meeting, right? I think they liked the idea, right? So so we would come out of meetings, like everybody was like, don't do it. So we just ignored all of that. And then we said we had a goal of, you know, if we raise $750,000, we'll do it full time. But if we don't, we both had consulting offers. If we don't, we'll go take our consulting jobs. So we raised like $75,000 and still decided to do it. One of our investors, again, another kind of one of these stories that just now is meaningful. At the time, you know, we didn't know how meaningful it would be. But one of our investors was Robert Kraft.
Not really.
Current owner of the New England Patriots. So his son was a classmate of ours. And again, how things happen and just networking and relationships. I was on a plane going to do some fundraising and Jonathan Kraft was on a plane. And he's like, hey, we recognize each other from school. And he's like, what are you doing? I said, well, I'm going to raise money. I have this magazine, pitched him the whole thing. He's like, oh, I think my mom may like that. He says, why don't you come meet my mom and my dad, you know, come meet us and we'll see what happens. I had no idea who Robert Kraft was. At the time, he didn't own the Patriots, but he owned a big paper company. So anyway, we met him. I thought this is what life was going to be like because we met him about an hour meeting. He wrote a check and said, tell me what I get for this. Good luck. And we walked out and we had an investment. So I was like, this is what life is going to be like now? You know, never happened again. But that's how we raised capital. And then we launched it. We were already running it and we started doing it full time. We moved to Baltimore. And then after about a year, just long story short, after about a year, we sold it to another company in Baltimore. Keith Klingscale, my partner, stayed with the magazine, and I went off to move back to Boston to work at a Bain & Company.
What's up, guys? Thanks for sticking with me to the end of the video. Truly appreciate you. If you like anything you heard here today, go ahead and hit that subscribe button. And if you know anybody that can benefit from this message, feel free to share. Peace and love.